a political critique. I don't know if you know this journal. This is based in Warsaw, and they are publishing very interesting work in English about Central Europe, and they are doing lots of interesting, they are running interesting stories. And there, with my two PhD students, there is the article we wrote about gender as symbolic glue. So I will be, you know, basing my arguments and the whole discussion on this article. And also we have a book we published together with several other scholars comparing France, Germany, Hungary, Poland and Slovakia with the title Gender as Symbolic Glue. And we were looking at how the conservative and far-right parties are positioning themselves in relation to the anti-gender mobilization, right? And I would like to start with a personal story that I edited a textbook, The History of Men and Women in the Long 20th Century in Hungary, which is a supplementary teaching material for secondary school. I mean, this is a solid women's history approach to make women visible. And we also had some teacher training programs, and then a friend of mine called me saying that, you know, in the Hungarian parliament somebody just submitted, one of the MPs submitted a question saying that how come that the Hungarian state is supporting the culture of death? And this concept that culture of death, that gender studies is supporting the culture of death, is of course was well known to me because I was teaching in the, at that time, a course on gender and politics, and I was teaching the gender concepts and the position of the Vatican on the complementarity and on men and women, the position of men and women in the society. And I was wondering that how come in the 2008 MP in the Hungarian parliament, who is not particularly, you know, well informed or well read, suddenly recognizes that that person needs to read this textbook and label it as a culture of death. So that already signaled that there is something changing, and I would like to, you know, somehow underline that what we see here is not a backlash, not a kind of anti-feminism. What we see is a paradigm change. We see there are major changes which are actually happening in the field of talking about gender equality. So this is a new phenomenon. This is my basic argument, this anti-equality discussion, which they are labeling as the culture, they are labeling gender equality as the culture of death. And this is there in the campus politics. I don't know if you are following what's happening in the US, when you know, a talk like this cannot be really organized without serious security, very rarely in the gender studies classrooms. And also gender studies became a kind of pop science that everybody has an opinion about what gender is. So from public intellectuals, journalists, cooks, waiters, waitresses, they all know what gender is, what gender studies is, instead of thinking about what gender studies, what kind of possibilities are there in gender studies and what gender does. And I wrote an article in the what is the impact of this new anti-equality discussion on the gender studies profession. And then it's a very interesting journal. I also would like to draw your attention. This is an online open access journal, Religion and Gender. And there was a special issue about what are the implications of that, this anti-gender movements on gender studies as a profession. So you might want to have a look at this as well. So what I will be talking about is what is this anti-gender movement, this anti-equality mobilization, why is this important? Then I will talk a little bit about why gender is a symbolic glue, which I already, you know, introduced as one of the important concepts. What kind of interpretations are there? What kind of frames can be used to for the interpretation? And what can we do? Što djelati, as the good Bolsheviks would say. So what can we do? So what are these anti-gender movements? The definition is easy, in a sense that a populist neoconservative responds to crisis of neoliberal world order. So please pay attention to each and every part of this definition. It's populist. It means that, you know, individuals are, you know, mobilized and participating in this process. It's a neoconservative response, in a sense, it's a counter movement, and I will tell you why this is an important part of the definition, and to a crisis of the neoliberal world order. It's a socializational movement in the Gramscian sense, as a response to the three intertwined crises, the financial security and the migration crises. So in a sense, this is a response to the already present structural problems, but the 2008 flashpoint actually made this even more visible. So what are the targets of these movements? First of all, the LGBTQIT movements and rights. The international convention, like the Istanbul Convention, which I don't think I need to explain here more, which is the Council of Europe Convention on protecting women from domestic violence, gender as a term. That's where I started the whole talk, that, you know, gender as a term and as a concept became a target. Gender mainstreaming, also the sexual education in schools, different transnational and international organizations like the European Union, the United Nations, and the WHO. Oh, of course, you can ask why the WHO, because they are very much promoting the sexual rights in the education. So here is the chronology of Hungary, and I will argue that this chronology is very much the same in the other countries as well. So if you look at this book, The Gender as Symbolic Glue, you can download it from the web. You see that there are the five countries we were analyzing. They also have the same triggers, right? But the triggers are coming in different time and they have a different impact, but the targets are the same. So it's basically a transnational movement. So this is not only in Croatia, not only in Hungary, not only in Macedonia. So in the case of Hungary, this is the chronology. Started, I mean, I have got this very dubious honor that the first time this concept, culture of death, was published and became, you know, well known because of the history textbook I did. In 2010, the sexual education in preschools received lots of attacks. Then in 2013, the Slovak episcopal letter was read in the Hungarian churches in Hungarian, which is pretty extraordinary in the Catholic Church. Then in 2014, the Estrela and Lunacek reports of the European Union actually triggered this response that, you know, gender is a culture of death. And 2015, there was a silence, so we were hoping that, you know, this will not continue. But unfortunately, in 2016, the debate about the female principium, that women have this special principium that they have to produce children, which was told by the speaker of the Hungarian parliament. And also the different sexual educational videos of the UNICEF, they all triggered a discussion about gender, gender studies, gender mainstreaming, LGBTQIT rights. And then the last phase, 2017, is the MA in gender studies was launched in Hungary and at ELTE, which is a public university. And then in 2017, there was the Let's CEU, where first the gender studies program was attacked, then the whole CEU was basically attacked. And of course, you can ask the question, why is this important? Because this is a mobilization of concerned citizens. So when you have got 1 million people marching on the streets of Paris against the gay marriage, I mean, you cannot say that all these people are stupid or uninformed. But you have to, you know, think about why are they doing what they are actually doing. This is a new political language. I use this concept, culture of death, right? So it is not something which, you know, you read every time in the political theory. This is a new language which operates via fear and hate. And it speaks about the hegemonic fight. It's a hegemonic fight for controlling the redefinition of human rights. So this is actually the key point, and I would like to flag that this is a redefinition of the human rights structure or institutions, what we already have after 45 in Europe, and this is redefining the meanings of the concepts, the institutions, and also the framework. And I will get back to this point. So when I promised you in this talk the new frame, I will get back to this point when I will be talking about how to how to analyze and how to look at this kind of phenomenon. Because this is a redefinition of neoliberal representative democracy, it creates new cleavages and cuts through political parties. So if you are following as closely as I do the different publications which are attacking gender studies and using anti-equality discourse for political mobilization, you see that there are very strange alliances. So the Russian Orthodox Church, together with the Polish Orthodox Church, which is pretty, you know, controversial, but also football fans and different politicians are basically united in order to create an alternative understanding of gender relations. And that already shows that we have got a problem, an analytical problem, a definitional problem. At the beginning, war between the state and the church, because it's pretty obvious that the language and the vocabulary, what we are using, what we see here, is coming from the church. Agnieszka Graf wrote an article saying that this is the exceptionalism, this is basically the post-communist Europe, Eastern Europe, which is only the site where this anti-equality movement is working. There are some others who are saying that this is a European unifying attempt, unifying Europe under different framework, eliminating the different differences by targeting an enemy group, which is the LGBTQ groups. And basically this is the rethinking of secular human rights based civil organizations, and this is a kind of outreach for creating a new framework of public activism, because these organizations are also NGOs, but they are not the good guys, right? They are not the good NGOs, but they are the unholy NGOs who are basically have been organized according to the same way. And you know, please keep this in mind when I will be talking about the possible interpretation frameworks later on. But they are supported by the state, so they are not non-government organizations, but government organizations. So they are gongos, not NGOs. And this is also a redefinition of the Enlightenment and the progressive emancipatory tradition. And especially if you look at how they are using science, and I will later talk a little bit about this, you will see that this is basically rethinking what science is, what scientific research is. And there is when we are analyzing it, we also have a problem about looking at the relationship between national and transnational, because you mentioned it is in Croatia, I can mention that it's in Hungary, but you know, if you see on Facebook a woman, you know, holding a very interesting statement, let's say in Spanish, against feminism, against gender equality, you can be sure that this kind of message will be available on Facebook in other languages in a week. So this is basically a transnational movement which is operating via different organizations and networks. So again, my main argument is that this is a new phenomenon, a fundamentalist answer to a broader systemic problem. So this is not, you know, about one person who is being ignorant. This is not about, you know, some masses of people who were misled and then they are just marching on the streets against abortion or gay marriage. So this is not about some people who are just stupid and they are just, you know, homophobic or racist or whatever. This is a basic response to a systemic problem. And this book we did about the anti-gender campaigns in Europe, the book is coming out also in French, because we are actually arguing that there are these various concerns of the concerned citizens united, and this why gender is a symbolic glue. So that's why there are these very strange coalitions which are actually formed. And there are different triggers in the different countries. So also in this book there is a kind of chronology where you can see when the certain issues are surfacing in the different European countries. And it's also connected with the disenchantment with politics. Namely that the language we are using when we want to talk about gender inequalities or issues related to gender, we very often use a language which is coming from public policy or from other disciplines, and they are somehow just scratching the surface when we are talking about the problems of 99% of the women. So, and also gender studies became a kind of elitist discipline in certain sense. So the point is that this kind of disenchantment and the non and the language which is really not ready to express and to give answers to the problems of the everyday problems, they actually led to a kind of disenchantment with these issues, unlike at the end of the 19th century where this discussion about inequality had been a part of the everyday political discussion. And this disenchantment led to the rise of this fundamentalist movement. So why gender is a symbolic glue? So we are arguing in this article, which was published in the Political Critique, that this is a proxy for the rejection of the current societal order. So it's a protest movement. Right, so those who are protesting against the migrants, the gay marriage, against George Soros, against the saying that they don't believe in global warming, they don't want vaccination for their children. So this is basically a protest against the current societal order. They are redefining citizenship in the sense that their position is a very different position as an active citizen. And this is a key rhetorical tool for neoconservative actors who aim to build a new common sense about what is normal and legitimate. So this is neoconservatives and what is new and legitimate in this new particular context. It's also an attack against the language of politics, which has become unsuitable to describe reality of more and more people, and more broadly, against the disenchantment of politics against the barbarian sense, as I mentioned. So, what we can learn from the failures of certain previous strategies. So what are the strategies which did not work, right? Rational explanations based on national specificities. Which is of course called, I'm sure you are familiar with this concept of methodological nationalism, saying that we in Croatia, we in Macedonia, we have this and this and this, we in Hungary. That really doesn't help because, as I said, there is this very interesting interplay between the national and the transnational, and this is a transnational movement which, you know, pops up in the countries in different times. What also doesn't work is saying the same, just loudly and more simple. I mean, if we don't address the root causes, then there won't be any change. So, because if you look at the responses, some gender studies programs actually started to put up on the web page explanations what gender is, right? Or a glossary or a vocabulary. This is not about them being stupid, not understanding what is there, right? But this is a different world order. This is a very different framework. Naming and shaming, saying that you are racist, you are stupid, you are homophobic, that doesn't really help either. And don't help either. And It also doesn't offer any kind of alternative. And also entering into a pro-contra debate in media, that also really doesn't help a lot. In from spring 2017, when this anti-equality war has erupted in Hungary and in globally, I have been, you know, invited to several debates and discussions, but I always rejected to participate in these pro and contra debates when, you know, I am the feminist, you know, the good guy, and there is somebody, you know, who is the bad guy, and then, you know, you cannot really win that kind of discussion because the framing puts you into a corner where you cannot really get out. So, what are the explanations? And I would give you three explanations why we are at the moment in this particular situation. The first is, of course, the church. And if you read this book, the European Anti-Gender Movement's book, which is now out in paperback, then you see that most of the authors are actually using the Kulturkampf, namely the state and the church. You know, where are the borders? Who is controlling the education? Who is controlling the science? Type of explanation. And also there is a response and an explanation saying that it was the church who the church. I mean, already that, you know, term is pretty problematic. What is the church? That it strikes back after the attacks related to the pedophilia charges. So this is a kind of positive PR activity. Also, there is the fight inside the Catholic Church between the fundamentalists and Pope Francis, who is more progressive in certain areas, and that this kind of political fight aimed to strengthen the position of the fundamentalist local churches. And there is another explanation which I think is really, really useful. That is Roman Kuhar's explanation, who is a Slovenian sociologist, who is saying that this whole movement is nothing else than the re-clericalization of the society. In a sense, if you are looking at these debates, you see that especially about the family and the family positions, the anti-gender, anti-equality camp is very often using scientific arguments. So in a report or in a research, this and this and this was claimed or argued or whatever. And then these kind of arguments, which are very, on the one hand, on the surface, they are very simple, obvious, objective arguments. On the other hand, they are basically re-clericalizing a secular scientific narrative, because this is normative research. So the research which is actually proving that the children who were brought up by a gay couple, they are more vulnerable to eating more sugar, for example, this kind of research is actually driven by ideological agenda. And that led to the second explanation, which is a paradigm change in science. And here is a quote from Yalcher, and he said, gender ideology ignores the existing scientific knowledge, end quote. And he was using here this concept of gender ideology. And this term gender ideology is basically created by this anti-equality transnational movement in order to create an enemy figure like, you know, George Soros or the migrants or, you know, and this term gender ideology, which basically doesn't exist, but it's a kind of ghost, and you can also put, you know, whatever you want, you can project into this concept. But it's really alarming that somebody who is expected to support the education and culture in the European Union basically declares this. And because they are using this kind of concept of existing biological differences, saying that, you know, this is complementarity there, men and women. So that's the term. And everybody who is, anybody who is basically questioning that can be shifted into this camp of those who are supporting gender ideology. And in this debate, what is really interesting, and I was so interested to see that you have got this publication about the state capture, the overregulation in Macedonia media and academia. Because the part of this fight, socializational fight, is not only about the science, but also the whole scientific mechanism, the scientific, what is science and what is scientific research. And you see that if you are reading the works by those who are questioning these kind of equality discussions, that they are coming from totally no-name institutions, and they are becoming professors. So you also see that there is a, there are different universities and different so-called experts are mushrooming, and I'm using this term mushrooming with a certain agenda in mind. Like Gabriele Kubi, who is the main ideologist of this anti-gender movement, who is labeled as a kind of renowned German sociologist who has got an MA, and she is always referred as professor, and you know, she doesn't have any kind of former appointment, but in one of these very dubious Hungarian higher educational institutions, which appointed her as a visiting professor. So I use this term mushrooming. So I mentioned mushrooming institutions, I was mentioning parallel civil societies, I was mentioning capturing certain agenda. And here is this article we wrote with my PhD student in the Huffington Post about the black protest. And you can also very legitimately ask why on earth we are writing to the Huffington Post. And this is a part of the strategy I would like to propose at the end of this talk, that we have to somehow translate our academic work into understandable language. And we published whatever is in this article in a peer-reviewed impact factor journal, but the main argument was also published in the Huffington Post. And this article was read by more than 200,000 people, translated to French and published in the Liberation, and also Estonian and Spanish. Unlike this peer-reviewed journal article, which was read by 237 readers. So that already, you know, shows that we have a problem, right? We have a problem of, you know, how do we communicate our research, and what is the role of these peer-reviewed journals. And in this article, we basically came up with the concept of the polypore state. So this is a very different interpretation than the state capture, because we are arguing that this polypore, before you start Googling what polypore is, the polypore is this mushroom which is living on the trunk of the tree, and it takes all the energy and material from the trunk of the tree, but it only produces further polypore. This is a kind of mushroom, which is a parasite which lives on the trunk of the tree. But when we were discussing how should we name this phenomenon, we were thinking about polypore is more elegant than mushroom or parasite, so we thought, you know, that's a good way to explain this. And our point was that there is this inability of progressive political forces to come up with an emotionally engaging alternative for visions of the future, which actually led us here, that there is this polypore trying to offer an other solution. But as I mentioned at the beginning, if you remember the definition of the anti-gender movement, a reaction, right? So that's why it's a polypore, because it's a reaction to the malfunctioning of the tree, and it creates another form of the state. So what are the characteristics of this polypore state? It creates a parallel civil society, the gongos I already mentioned, so they are just basically mirroring the agenda which is there in the tree. And if you are reading the CEDAW reports, I'm sure you know the CEDAW commission is expecting the member states to, those states which ratify the CEDAW convention to submit reports about the status of women. And if you read the CEDAW report of Poland, Hungary, Mexico, I should have checked the CEDAW report of Macedonia, but I mean, I would recommend you to read it and check if there is the question, what is the status of women in economy? Then the response is, families are doing well, right? So the women are basically disappearing from the discourse. And then there is this question, how many civil societies are promoting women's rights? There are lots of women's societies, women's organizations, but they are supported by the state and not by the civil organizations. And they are basically transmission belts of the government. So this so they can report that they have got lots of human rights based organizations, but they are not. And that's that is the kind of new framework I would like to, you know, highlight in this talk, that it actually operates in the framework of the human rights institutions and framework of the United Nations, but it means totally different thing, right? So these parallel civil societies, they are not promoting women's rights, but they are promoting mothers. They are not promoting women in academia, but they are helping working mothers to work in academia, right? So there is basically a very different agenda. The next is the security narratives. There is always an enemy against which they can articulate the their message, like the migrants, the LGBTQI, the gay, the lesbians, George Soros, whatever. So they need an enemy against which this kind of discussion is possible. And the third is that privileging family over women's rights, and that's what is called familialism. So they are not talking about women, but they are talking about families. And the polypore state, the modus operandi of the polypore state is requiring a very different resistance strategy and a very different protest strategy. And my basic argument is this illiberalism is not a backlash, but a new form of state. So therefore, there are certain responses which are actually strengthening the polypore state instead of, you know, cutting it off from the trunk of the tree. So what are these strategies? We need proactive and independent strategies. So do not react. Do not, very often, you know, feminists are rushing into the different TV studios or writing articles or open ads and whatever, and then there is a response, and there is a response, and then the whole thing is going on, instead of putting forward something which is a message, right? Instead of saying what the other is saying is not good, right? Addressing the causes and not the surface, and also using this as a moment for self-reflection, what went wrong? And simply reflecting on the present situation of feminism, feminist theory, and gender equality, which is, you know, declining every part of the world, not as something as a misery or something which is a fateful, unforecastable event, but something where we have a responsibility and we have to, you know, reflect on our own position and our own responsibility. And also to try to connect the local levels and experiences with the different organizations. So not this enlightened top-down perspective, but trying to basically look at the local level, what kind of issues are there. And trying to create this dialogue, this space for discussion to prevent the escalation of the of this kind of debates, but not to explain, but try to find new allies and try to learn how to listen and how to address the very legitimate feeling of fear, and trying to think about a new language which is actually helping us to address these kind of issues and inequalities. And in this dialogue, Chantal Mouffe's distinction between the agonistic and antagonistic fight is very useful, because, you know, you can say that you are naive if you believe that these people who are labeling you as an agent of the culture of death would be listening to what you are saying. But I'm just smiling and saying, no, of course, but let's hear the arguments. Let's get into a discussion, and then we will see what happens. So it's also the intersectional approach. I mean, everything and everywhere is intersectional now in feminist theory. But I would like to, you know, mention one methodological aspect of the intersectionality, this, which is asking the different question, trying to find our blind spots, the unconscious bias. So what kind of problems are there with our positionality? And this kind of intersectional approach helps us a lot. And also stereotyping the other, the concern, looking at the self-ghettoization, that nobody's listening to us, but, you know, it's easy for us to be in this environment. That's also very dangerous. So this kind of intersectional approach of avoiding self-ghettoization is actually a good way. And I would like to show you a 2-minute film, which is a good example, and I would be happy to take questions after that, which is how we are doing it in Hungary. And I would like to say that, of course, I mean, this is a series of discussion about topics which are important in feminist theory, like care, love, masculinity, politics. But we were trying to create these forums discussing these inequalities, labor, which are important, but we try to invite those who are coming from very different background, and they are having a very different position, in order to discuss these topics. And, you know, on the website of the Ebert Foundation, and this is also interesting, why a social democratic German foundation is the only founder who could, you know, organize and create this kind of dialogue. They are all available on the website. There are books which we produced on this, and it created a network of people who are thinking about the same issues differently, but not in a way that they are excluding other opinions. So, of course, nobody was, you know, changing their mind. You know, this is not like Athena jumping out from the head of Zeus that, oh, now I will think differently. It's a process. So I just would like to share with you this the film which we had about the equality. No. Yes. If this. Oh, this.
Many people get together and can discuss on one topic from many sides. is very useful also for me because I can bring some new ideas to Slovakia about what is going on in Poland, in Hungary, and in other countries.
Nagyon jó olyan emberekkel beszélgetni, akikkel tudományosan vagy állampolgárként nem értek egyet. Mert ez megtermékenyít, rákényszerít arra, hogy a saját gondolataimat tisztában egyértelműen fogalmazzam meg, pontosabban definiálja azokat a fogalmakat, amiket használok, és szerintem ez előmutató dolgi már nem élveztem ezt a vitát.
Nagyon fontos volt, hogy dominikánus nővérek, szakszervezeti aktivisták, LGBT aktivisták, nőjogi aktivisták, tudósok, filozófusok egy teremben arról beszéltek, hogy milyen lehetőségek vannak arra, hogy elkerüljük, hogy ez a vita Magyarországon is megjelenjen.
So that's the quiz question, which year this was made? Based on the talk, you will be able to answer to this. Do you remember the chronology? So what year is this was? Right, when we believe that this will be, you know, can be avoided. So you can already say, you know, very legitimately say that, you know, this was an illusion, right? We failed. And on the one hand, you are right, because we could not push this whole international and transnational wave of redefining equality and human rights back. But I would say the situation in Hungary is even better, still better than Poland and Slovakia. In Poland you have got smoke bombs thrown to rooms like this, when we have a discussion on gender. You cannot apply any of the state funding when you have gender as a term in the application. The highest ranking state civil servant in Slovakia was attacked in her office in the ministry. So, I mean, we are talking about sheer violence, right? So that's what Agnieszka Graf was referring to. I mean, aggression and violence. I mean, this is still not happening in Hungary. So, and I, of course, as a part of the hubris, I consider that this is one of our achievements. Those who in the past 5 years have spent a lot of time, intellectual and emotional energy to talk and to discuss and to, you know, try to be in a dialogue with the outside world, and we are open for other arguments. So that, I believed, was one of the reasons why we are not in this horrible situation. There is an MA program in Hungarian in gender studies, and you know, scholars who are working on gender studies still have a job. And I just read today the interview with the president of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences, saying that there is more research needed in gender studies. So, I mean, what else do you want? So, I mean, I think this is a kind of good reflection on our solid academic, professional and outreach activity that, you know, slowly but firmly we were radiating certain issues. So that was it, and I'm happy to take questions. Thank you for your interest.